Great. Thank you for coming, everyone. We are.
Thank you, Blue.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, EFS Capstone team.
Yeah. So, for those, for prosperity's sake, we are the Flight Ready Electric Feed System Capstone for the 2018-2019 Mechanical Engineering sets of Capstone thingies. We were sponsored by PSAS, which is why we're here. We were also sponsored by Oregon NASA Space Grant Consortium, which gave us some money to buy controllers with. Our industry advisor was Andrew, and then our academic advisor is Balder Steingrimson. I hope that's right. This is the team, starting over there, Shaylee, Henry, Nick, Anas, Phil, myself. Some sweet glam shots throughout the year as we go through. Ignore this agenda, this is old. And, I mean, it's more or less the same. It's going to be project requirements, design, manufacturing results, and then onboarding, which is what this whole thing is about. We pass this on to the next crowd, and we keep going from here. So the proposal for this project was to develop an electric feed system to pump two propellants for a liquid rocket engine. So basically, an electric feed system is just an electronically controlled smart pump system. Two pumps, one for each propellant for the rocket engine. These were the requirements that we had at the beginning of the year, changing throughout the entire year. So this is sort of the final set off. We had to make sure that the pumps were tested with the actual propellants, more or less some changes. Couldn't do liquid oxygen, even though that's what the pump is for, because of insurance reasons. So we stuck with liquid nitrogen, which gave us the cryogenic capabilities. And then isopropyl alcohol, just to test the stuff there, but we'll get to why that never happened with that pump. For safety reasons, we had to make sure these pumps were designed to keep fluids separated. So no leaks, no cross pumping, no lines being crossed, no chance of fluids contacting each other because these fluids are designed to combust. So if they're pre-mixing, that's a dangerous hazard. Emergency shutoff procedure with battery cutoff, which we had during testing. This 450 PSI, I think, works out okay, but the testing team still never got to where they were supposed to be to give us a final value. So for now, we're going to say that it was 450 as a deliverable pressure with a positive suction or an inlet pressure. I'm just going to say an inlet pressure of 45 to 100. That's also up in the air because we never had composite tanks finalized to give us some number, but we know it's somewhere in this ballpark. That's what we were designing for, and that's what we are going with. But since they don't exist, they don't exist.
What is NPSH again?
Net positive suction head. That's slightly different than what an inlet pressure is. That's inlet pressure minus vapor pressure, I think, more or less.
Sort of. And it's in like different units. It's in feet or meters. It's just a weird pump lingo for a conversion of what you need your inlet pressure to be in order to make the fluid rise a certain amount.
Okay.
It's just a weird metric that the pump industry.
So the 450 PSI was the inlet pressure.
That's the delivery.
I'm sorry.
So we must deliver propellants at 450 with a net positive suction head at 45 to 100 PSI.
Okay.
So
it's
we
coming
exit
from the tanks.
Yeah.
It's coming from the tanks at 45 to 100. And we're delivering it to the pintle at 450.
Yes, thank you.
That's what it is.
Okay.
So while we deliver it at something, it should leave the pump at like 450 because that was minus all the losses that Jacob estimated. That way, by the time it finally got to the engine, it was still above chamber pressure. But chamber pressure, I think, is still 350. Again, there's some numbers that were never finalized. So that's what we went with there.
450 was rounding up too.
It was.
I think they gave us 75 as the
75, I think it was they had for their losses for the first pintle. Second pintle, I know, was a little bit less, but anyways. Embedded sensors for data acquisition, we never got to that point because some stuff froze and the other pump didn't work. And then this is sort of a long stretch goal, which is what needs to happen with the next set of iterations, is the feedback. So these two here are pretty well related. Once you have pressure transducers and flow meters to work with this pump, that needs to talk to the engine and all the management system, because that's going to be sort of an auto cycling set. So if the engine starts needing more thrust, it should just tell it needs more thrust, and then it's sort of this cyclical cycle where it keeps checking in on itself in closed loop feedback. So those two are to be happening later. Must be compatible with liquid oxygen. That was on the lower end just because we were never going to be able to test with it, but everything we designed for the cryo pump is liquid oxygen compatible, and that was still something we kept high up, but we kept it on the low requirements because we were never going to get the test on campus with it. Engineering requirements, this again kind of comes down to what we had, what we estimated. So 450 was the final exit pressure. This is the mass flow rate, which is currently correct for the 2.2 according to Corey. The power that we had, so total shaft power was 5 kilowatts. That's both of the, that's rounded up. That's both of the, there are two, if you look there, there are two independent engines, but combining the two requirements that you need, that's a high rounding error for how much power you need to drive both pumps. So rotational speed of the impeller for the alcohol pump is 35,600. For the liquid oxygen pump, it's 24,400. Engine thrust, these were designed for a 2.2 kilonewton engine, which is the engine we currently have, and I think the engine they're going to kind of keep going with for now, even though it'll be a heat sink engine. And then the module diameter that we have is 12-inch, which is still ongoing according to Corey's MDO calculation. So that all fits. Everything is designed to fit inside the 12-inch module. So all that should still be good to go for all those reasons.
So I want to go back for a second.
One more?
No, this is
okay.
Good. So these are the requirements that we gave you, plus or minus.
Plus or minus a whole year's worth of to do this, do that.
Yeah, right. Okay, good.
Yes.
And so these are the final engineering requirements.
These were the final ones.
And this is to get to a 2.2 kilonewton engine, but not anymore. This won't fire a 4 kilonewton engine.
Go for it.
I was going to get into that a little bit. I actually have a calculation spreadsheet on the GitHub now. That is how we came to these values. And from that, we found that in order to scale up for higher thrust, we actually don't have to change the pump geometry whatsoever. It's all a matter of power density. And some people in industry have confirmed that with us because we didn't really believe it at first.
It's kind of weird to think.
But it's a trade-off of more power and actually lower RPM for the pump with the same geometries is going to give you increased mass flow rate and increased pressure.
Okay, and you should touch on this later. I just wanted to see. But I still want to say that this design, these motors that you've done, is just for 2.2 kilowatts.
This here
is
for 2.2.
Okay, good. Thank you.
And if you wanted to go for the other one, these will lower, and this will slightly go up.
Yep, okay.
That's it. Basically, you're hitting the fluid harder, slower.
Right.
Design?
So this up here is the first iteration of the electric feed system from the 2016 Capstone. This one was, originally they wanted to shoot for liquid oxygen testing, just like we wanted to do, but it quickly became a water pump, as I understand it. They evaluated the situation and realized, no, we can't get that fast. So they made the goal of making a water pump to see what kind of pressure gains they could achieve. So that's what we picked up from with the assignment to split it off into a dual pump system for each fluid. So the original design concepts we came up with were to at first share a drive system. So we were going to have a single higher power motor that was driving both pumps separately. And we came into some issues with that really quickly. The design in the middle where they're actually pumped inline, once we started doing design calculations, we realized it was not possible whatsoever. They're going to have different RPMs in order to account for the different fluid properties, so it just wouldn't work. The design on the left technically could work. It has a gearbox in the middle, and if you did your gear ratios right, you could distribute the
move along,
rotational
move
speed.
Along.
Yeah, they didn't work. Long story short, we're like, nope. So we came to this conclusion. Let's put two separate motors. We can design two completely different systems that work in line with each other. They use the same motor, same ESC, same whole power system, so they're just a duplicate of one another. We overpowered the IPA or the IPA pump motor, so we knew that it would work for both pumps. Yeah, that's the final design that we ended up on, which is right here. Do you want to talk about this?
Yeah. So this is the on the note of power components. This is sort of the power components. The picture on the left is where we were at around winter term. So we had, I'll just go from the top. So we had selected a TV Power, which is a brand. and it's a brushless DC motor. It's a three-phase motor that turns two poles on, two poles off, two poles on, in a rotation of six, and that's how the motor spins around. It's similar to an AC induction motor, but it's technically called a brushless DC, but I've been told they're the same. That puts out 5 kilowatts of power total, and it'll spin up to a maximum of 60,000 RPM. So this motor is quite oversized for even both pumps in both instances, but it gave us a chance to just have the power if we needed it and kind of play with that to see if that was too much, then we can scale back down. But it was better for us to start with more than not enough, because then we're just not doing anything. These, the Sword Fish is also another brand. It's an electronic speed controller, and what that does is it basically just gives that motor a firing schedule. That's all it does. It turns off and on the two poles, as mentioned, at a certain rotation. It was, when I selected it because it was programmable, but doesn't really do anything. Like, you can set a couple things on there, but the system doesn't really actually give you much programming. So really, the way it's controlled, if you look at that little box, there's an Arduino in there and a shield that was soldered together with a knob. Eventually, we were hoping to get further along with that, but we never got to that point. And then the batteries down there are lithium polymer batteries. They're 5,000 milliamp hours or 5 amp hour batteries. And there was 3 of them wired in parallel, which gave us plenty of energy to run a full set of system for one pump. In theory, if we were running both of them at the same time, we would actually need a whole other set of this for the next one. We never ended up getting to that point. So what we had is just, we were able to just trade off the power components, which was pretty convenient.
Are you guys mechanical engineers?
We are mechanical engineers. So
it's in series.
The batteries are
in series. Yes. No, they're in series.
No, they're not.
Are they in parallel?
They're in parallel. Those are in parallel because we're not changing the voltage. We're changing the current.
What's the voltage of the batteries?
24.2.
Oh.
They're 6S LiPos. So 6-cell batteries.
Oh, okay.
Each cell is 3.7 volts per cell.
Right. Thank you. So it's a 6S3P pack.
Yes.
Is what that means.
Yep.
Okay.
6S3P.
So it's 24 volts times a maximum of 200 amps is what's 25 times 200? That's 5 kilowatts, roughly, a little less than 5 kilowatts.
More or less.
So your ESC was rated to run your.
That was rated for 200. It was not rated to run the full power because we didn't need it. Our final calculations at full throttle, at the highest pressure, we were only supposed to pull 186 amps.
Okay.
If all systems work well, which we learned very quickly that doesn't actually happen.
Right.
So, but it was 186 amps. We oversized the batteries well above because that was where the fire hazards were. So we oversized those. There's 70C discharge rate. So in theory, those could, according to the manufacturer, could safely pump out 350 amps each without damage. So we were well within the safety margin for the batteries. And the reason they were in parallel is because that way we could pull as much current as we need, and it's not doing it from one battery, rather than doing it in series. Plus, the voltage needed to stay at the 6S to match the motor and the ESC. Because that one, the ESC is only rated for up to 6S. It couldn't do any more, any higher voltage than that without having some sort of damage.
Thank you.
So this is the real, basically that's a little roadmap. These are the real components that we set up back in winter term, and just kind of side-by-side comparison of everything.
Two further questions.
Yes.
The potentiometer knob on the Arduino,
yep,
is read by the analog digital converter.
Yep.
That then makes a pulse width RC whatever
hertz
signal thing.
It does hertz from 1,000 to 2,000 hertz. 1,000 being no throttle, 2,000 being full throttle.
Okay, thanks. And that's just a standard RC thing.
Yep. That is just the standard thing that comes with that. That's when it reads. So unfortunately, it is kind of annoying because the pop will start at zero,
yep,
to 2,000. So there's kind of a dead zone in there. But the whole point of having the pop was that eventually we were going to have live stream the Arduino to figure out where the hertz were at, where the full throttle was that we were getting pressure. And then that was just going to get coded into a sequence. But we never got to that point for that spot.
And talk about cooling.
Oh, so fun. Only one pump needs cooled. But the one that does need cooling. So this little tank was a basic sheet of aluminum that I rolled and welded to this little water tank. And the point of this is the ESC comes with an aluminum cooling jacket already pre-installed. And this guy has an accessory cooling jacket. That is just to make sure that the heat running through these wires is not going to melt anything. These in the speedboats that I've seen will melt themselves before they will fry anything if they're running enough current fast enough. Where this guy just gets damaged after 100C. So the point of this test was actually to see we'll get to it on the next slide, but basically this is for thermal energy management. And the point of it was to find out if this system could be cooled with water on full throttle, and if it couldn't, that was going to be a problem, because if the plan is to cool these in the rocket with the isopropyl alcohol, which has even less, it has less energy to pull because it's 70% alcohol and only 30% water. So if it couldn't be cooled with water, we were going to figure out a way to super cool the alcohol, maybe wrap it around the LOX tank or something, but we can't run LOX through it to cool it because that's just dumb. And we'd have to somehow cool it. So eventually we were going to get to some thermal testing, but if you go to the next slide, I can keep talking on that. So we did that. We did, for our 411 test, that was what our focus was, because we wanted to set up these power components and run them over and over and over and over until we figured out what sort of thermal energy transfer we were getting at steady state 10. The only problem was, at this point in stage, we didn't have anything to load the motor with. So it was just free spinning. So it actually wasn't even working that hard. It didn't run more than 8 amps. So we didn't get a lot of information from it, but we did at least understand where the hot spots were. So when we ran it, most of the heat was just right here on the back of the engine, and then the ESC itself got a little hot. But that was about it. The water at this energy was more than cool. It went up 10 degrees in probably 2.5 hours worth of just cycle testing it over and over and over again. So we didn't get a whole lot of trouble there, but that was, again, sort of a, just to see if it worked. And everything worked. All the water system this time worked just fine. We had no leaks, no problems. This was just in the EPL, and we got to play with the floor cam, which was pretty cool.
One of the questions that someone asked me is, do you dynamometer the motors? And we don't have access to a dynamometer.
I did not think to even try that, but that would have been really cool to hook it up to some like dynamometer to see what kind of power we could actually get out of it. That
do
would have
you
been
have
really
one
cool.
at Portland State? You
know, I don't know if they have one for an RC.
What's a dynamometer?
If you take an engine, you hook it up, and you find out what kind of power it is. A lot of people do it for their cars. They just call it, they short it for a dyno. You roll your car up onto it or your motorcycle. You rev the crap out of it, and you find out the actual power that's actually going, in the car's case, to the wheels. In our case, it would be to the shaft. So the actual, after losses, after everything, it's the real value of numbers that your motor's putting out. Because you can calculate it with energy by knowing the voltage and the amps that's going through it. You know the power. But after losses, if you hook it up to a dynamometer, you would find out exactly what that thing's actually putting out in real life. Counting losses. Minus losses. So, but I don't know if they have one on campus. I can see if maybe Vikings have one, if the race team have one. But I don't know if they'd have one that small.
Yeah, right. Okay.
But that would be really cool. I'm sure somebody can make one for RCs, which would be pretty cool to have one. Next slide. I keep going. So this is our test stand, the little potato thing back there. So we were kind of doing this in tangent with the test stand team, but we figured it would be easier for us to have our own test stand for us. Just, it was a little mobile system because our pumps are kind of small and test stand was pretty well involved with all their stuff. So we figured let's just build something small to test. So inside of this little foil thing is a Harbor Freight air tank. It was $40 and relatively inexpensive. And it was cut apart with holes and stuff drilled to it, new mounts welded to the side. And then that little stand was just made out of some 2-inch box section and welded up. And the point of having this stand was it allowed us to sort of do our own independent testing just outside the shop or at my garage. And it just made it really easy to mobile load the pumps, test them, and then put everything back together and just have something. Originally, this was not designed for cryo, but you'll notice there is some foil because we ended up trying it. Because originally the goal was to have this test stand work for both pumps, as you'll see there, dual pump compatible, but I was going to make another tank for the cryo one. One made out of aluminum that wasn't mild steel because I figured it would survive more likely, but the mild one actually survived, which is still astonishing. The paint may have chipped, but I haven't opened it up to see if the paint came off. But essentially it just started in CAD, basically started with this pump diagram and then scaled up from there in real life in CAD. Took those things and just made it in real life, which was pretty simple from there. Those little wheels, which are like $5. You ever needed some new ones? Pretty cheap. It's relatively inexpensive, and it's just super easy to have. It's just something that's mobile. It was also used for pencil testing, which was really convenient as well.
I have a question on that. You modified it. Is that not safe for putting pressure in at this point?
Oh, no, it's good.
So if I want to put 100 PSI in there for doing additional pencil testing?
Run it. I haven't tested it up to 100. But it works at least up to 60 without leaks.
What's the tank rated at?
The tank from Harbor Freight is 125.
Okay.
And then
so,
I cut a bunch of holes in it and then rewelded them up.
Okay.
But I was able to get 100 PSI after the first set of welding. After I made the mounts, the bottom hole, and the side hole, I was able to go up to 100 PSI without issue. Not a single leak, nothing wrong.
As far as your pump, as far as your compressor would take it, whatever that is.
That was, that'll also go up to 100.
Yeah,
but I hit
it.
It
goes over 100.
It goes over, well, maybe a little bit.
Yeah.
But I hit it with shop air at work, and that was 100 PSI. Jacob hit it at over 100 PSI without any problems. So it'll hit that at least. But it hasn't been, so this top plug, this is a 2-inch MPT plug. That was a final thing that I cut and welded like 2 weeks ago. And that has yet to be tested up to over 100 PSI. But it didn't break with cryo in it at 60, so I'm feeling relatively good about that.
Is that
going
to live in the test in the rock room for a while?
I figured we discuss everything after this meeting to figure out where this stuff is going to live, but I assume if we have room, it should just live in the rock room because it is easier than moving and wheeling the big guy.
It's very useful for injection testing.
So I kind of figured it would live there just because.
Where else would it live?
Yeah, and because I don't want to cut it apart. Pretty cool little thing, and it's convenient, but again, that was more, I figured we'd have a discussion where we want to put everything afterwards. So that's that. It's half-inch MPT connectors. I'm still calling it a max of 125 because that's what it was right from the manufacturer, and as far as I saw, I didn't change any of those dynamics, but I don't want to go past that because I'm not going to rate it past what it is. Little mobile station, and that is just a mild steel tank, so things to look out for is water at the bottom. Because it does hold water at the bottom. It's like a small layer, but you're going to get rust. So if you do any testing with this stand, make sure you flush it out before you took whatever propellant you want to put inside it. So make sure you're not putting rust flakes through your components, because that's how you clog things. So just something to keep in mind is that is, especially if it never gets unwrapped and even with the paint, you'd never know. It is mild steel, so there will be rust inside it. Just wash it out, rinse it out, hit it with air, compressed air, clean it out, and then your tank's just fine. Your test just makes. So make sure you're not putting rust flakes through your components. Wanna go with this?
Yeah. So we did some testing with liquid nitrogen on our pump components. We wanted to figure out the best way to account for the thermal deformation that was going to go on in the pump. So what we ended up doing is we took the components that had vital geometries, so the impeller and shaft, we did the impeller housing itself and a few other components. We found the most critical dimensions that might cause issues in the dynamics of the pump when it cooled down. And we dunked them, we timed them for 2 minutes each, and we measured the values. And with the differences that we found, we plotted them and came up with a formula that, with reasonable accuracy, we were able to use for the rest of the pump, just to give us a oversize factor for how much the parts were going to contract. And it ended up being different from theory. We think that was because we're not letting it sit for 20, 25 minutes to a full steady state, where if you just plug in your values to the equation in textbook, you say like, oh, this is how much it's contracted. That's assuming that it's fully contracted and we're actually not going to be. So these are the values that we ended up with for the final IPA pump design.
Sorry, go back for just a minute.
Yeah.
So are those measurements in their final report?
I actually have
a... I think it's a set. We made a whole... Phil made a whole separate report.
Yeah,
this
we have a separate, separate document.
Which we will upload as well.
Okay, good.
But
yeah.
that is a whole... This wasn't in our final report. This was a whole report in itself that we did for ourselves.
Okay.
But if I'm honest, though, I think this would be nice to redo just because when we ended up trying the cooling test, we were on that pad for a lot longer than what we were cooling these things for.
Yeah.
So that's something to redo.
It's hard because we weren't fully submerged either.
Yeah.
So
okay.
We can get a bigger number or something set up, though.
So this is still a guess, but it's a slightly more educated guess.
Yeah.
It is a slightly more educated guess.
Thank you.
That was pretty cool. That was pretty cool.
So this is our final IPA pump design, which didn't work for a number of reasons that we're going to get into. But the optimized pump specs were a 3-inch impeller diameter, rotating at about 36,000 RPM. With 1.7 kilowatt power. We selected a Flowser pack seal, which is a bellow style seal, and it's what the last Capstone team used. It worked just okay for them, and it worked a little bit less than okay for us. We also used a stainless steel axial thrust bearing, which in the initial tests for the IPA pump didn't work out too well, but we used it in conjunction with another bearing in the cryo pump, and that ended up going pretty well, which we'll get into further as well. And for both pumps, we selected 6061 aluminum as the best material. I think one of the main reasons for this was because we were manufacturing everything in-house, and it was just
easy. It's nice. It's soft.
Can you point out which is which in that diagram?
This is the Flowser pack seal. This is the...
That's just the retaining ring for the seal. So that's what's actually compressing the spring of the seal. That's not...
So this is actually aluminum component that should have been the same color, but it might just be SolidWorks. So inside of here is a single piece with a spring, and then inside of here is a piece of the seal that doesn't rotate. The way the seal is designed to work is that fluid and compression pushes in on this spring, and it seals around the shaft on this end. So as fluid goes around the outside of this seal, it can't go through it. And then it won't go anywhere along the seal because this part has a piece of rubber that jams over top of that seal. Problem we ran into when we were testing stuff is that the first time we did this, there was too much room in the front and it was grinding inside of the case. So it wasn't misaligned. And then the second time we ran it, we forgot to lubricate the seal. And so this thing, it wasn't allowed to move. So if you imagine a spring force being pushed and then it can't actually slide, you're not transmitting any force to this part. So the spring was just held together under compression, but it wasn't actually transmitting anything this way. Yes, sir.
So is this pretty similar to like a mechanical seal you'll find in most water cool dynamics?
Pretty much.
Yeah.
So how do you deal with water that flows past that seal? Do you have a weep hole or?
There was nothing in this pump.
Okay.
I think if we had more time to design a system where it could recirculate through, that would be awesome. That was something we found out in an industry talk with a gentleman. But we didn't get to that point. We were just hoping it would just seal it and not leak at all. Because inside of this bearing case is a bunch of lubricant, which can't get wet, but it did. So.
But we're also, sorry.
Sorry, so the flow surface that rotates.
This guy?
That, yep, the thing next to it to the right, the aluminum does not rotate.
This does not.
And then what's the thing? Yeah, keep going.
This is a thrust bearing. This does rotate.
Okay. And the shaft of the, propeller was up against that thrust bearing.
Yes. So you can't see it in here, but there is a sort of collar that slides out. So the shaft is stepped. It's 5/16, or I'm sorry, 8 millimeter. Sorry, Brie, you're going to hate this. It's 8 millimeter to half inch. It's 8 millimeter to half inch. The reason it's 8 millimeter is because this is German. So this shaft is 8 millimeter, so thus this has to be 8 millimeters. But it's 8 millimeters to half inch. So in between this step is a collar that stops at the step and then fills the gap for the ID of the bearing grease. So it spins freely inside of there, and it doesn't touch anywhere inside of here, and then it seals around this seal. So that's what that is.
Thank you.
Do you want to go into this guy too?
No, go for it.
So this is what we ended up testing for the cryo test. It's got an impeller of 2.5. Inches, so it's a little bit smaller. RPM we ended up calculating was about 24,000 at 2.1 kilowatts of power. So a little bit slower rotation with more power. Because the setup that we just described for a long time didn't work exactly as we had hoped, we adjusted the design a little bit. We added a entirely ceramic bearing right here this piece right here in conjunction with the axial thrust bearing. We had some alignment issues with the first pump, and this change, among a couple other changes, really, really helped to alleviate that problem. I think that was a big change.
That was it, yeah,
for this.
Sure.
How did you seal the cryo? That's cryo.
So,
oh, yes.
We have a cryo seal.
So that's where we sort of just make one. So Nick, if you go back one more, there's a little blue piece. One more. There's a little blue piece in there. that you can't quite see because it's curly cut now. Basically what it is we mimicked the shaft collar that we made for the IPA pump, only we made it out of Teflon, and we made it to press fit over the shaft. So nothing could leak by it, and we were hoping that as we compress, so this plate compresses these two bearings together, that way nothing moves, we were hoping that compression would seal the outside. Didn't work, but it was sort of a makeshift thing. We'll get into seals and where that the real seal is actually going to live inside of this guy, and this will just be some small aluminum piece. And these seals, these bearings could be much smaller. We just picked bearings that were going to work for the parts we already had designed, since a lot of this kind of came in. A lot of lessons learned last minute, so we sort of tried to make it fixed, and we did get it to fix, but these are oversized. We can make these a lot smaller, and then this piece doesn't need to be in there at all, because the seal would live in the gold piece there.
Going to talk about the material. We chose the same material.
Yeah.
We I think during the first term we had a lot of discussion about whether or not we would actually be able to consider 6061 LOX compatible.
Mm-hmm.
We were at first advised against it, I think, but the more research we did into it, the more we found that it's actually considered completely compatible. We found Boeing and NASA documentation saying to use it all the time. So. It just made the most sense at that point. We're like, okay, if it's LOX compatible, we're going to move forward with it. The only negative side of the selection for the cryo pump is that aluminum will contract a little bit more. So that's something we had to account for. But it made machining so much easier and cheaper.
Other than the aluminum, is there any other metals that are in there on the fluid paths? That
this is stainless. This is stainless. This is Teflon. And then that's moving to the ceramic. So
right.
That guy hardly moves at all.
Something that they're going to be exposed to water or liquids that might lead to corrosion for its maintenance.
Is the stainless shouldn't? This is a 304 bearing, so 304L, so it's food safe stainless steel. It should never, and there's no lubrication in this one. In theory, this would actually be really nice if we could do a ceramic outer with maybe a stainless inner, or just do all ceramic on both bearings. That way we don't have any corrosion. But the aluminum, if you leave water in there, aluminum will also corrode as well.
Yeah, we know.
But yeah, so I mean, the case itself has corrosion issues with it, and that comes in our procedure part where you flush everything out and you just pump it full of air until it's completely bone dry, then store it. Because you shouldn't be taking it apart. I mean, if you can avoid it, you shouldn't be taking it apart to clean it. You should be able to blow it out completely and then.
Would you say if you stick it in, say, a 200 Fahrenheit oven, or would something melt in there?
I don't know if that would damage the ceramic, because something with ceramics and glass, you can't, they have a very specific heat cycle. You can't ramp them up and cool them down super fast. So once you start adding heat to ceramics, you get into fractures. Because if you put something in an oven and it goes too fast, it's just going to crack.
So no baking.
No baking. And I don't know that. I didn't look into that because that's something we ever planned on.
At a low temperature, 100 degrees.
It's got to go super slow. That's the thing. So like when we kiln fire glass, we're super slow bringing it up and even slower bringing it down. That ceramic bearing is going to act the same way that our glass is. If you go up too fast, it's just going to crack. So it's not something that's normally
done. Not much above ambient, but I'm saying just enough to help 100 degrees Fahrenheit, say, to help speed up the.
It's not the temp. So it's not that you could heat that up as high as you want. It's how you get there. So again, if you just throw it in an oven, even if you're just going to 100, if that delta T is too high, it breaks.
Blow dryer through it.
I would not put a blow dryer. Oh, a blow dryer?
Yeah, blow dryer.
That might be okay. That might not be hot enough to do it, but I don't know that for sure.
Boca is a manufacturer?
Yes, Boca is a manufacturer.
And was that ceramic bearing unicorn, or was it easy to get?
No, that was relatively easy. Helen had to call somebody, and they shipped it within a week.
Okay.
So you did have to contact their sales and say, hi, this is the one we want, and they put it through for you.
Okay.
It wasn't just like a...
And it wasn't like $8,000?
No, it was like...
$76.
Okay.
I think. No, $86.
Wasn't that much? I thought it was cheap.
No, it was expensive. It was in the upper. It was like 80,
yeah,
no more than $90, but no less than 7, somewhere in there. I think he was actually annoyed we were only buying one, though. I don't think that's normally their business,
gotcha.
But we needed just one. So, but yeah, it wasn't terrible. But that one's all ceramic. The ball is inside of ceramic, and the both raises are ceramic as well. Something kind of nifty about these is that when we designed the two bearing system, These are, I think, are actually sort of designed to do that, because the outer diameter of this first piece is different than the second piece. So technically, you can squeeze two of these together with the outer races on the outside at clearance, and the middle ones don't touch anything. So that's where you get that free spin in the middle. So you stick something in between there that touches the in, and then the ID of this guy is smaller than the ID of this guy. So nothing touches the inside of that, while nothing touches the outside of that. So if you stick two together and you press them together so they don't move, the internals can spin freely, which is pretty cool. So I think that's actually kind of why they designed to do that. Because when we first got it, I was really confused as to why this one didn't match this one. But after doing the dual bearing design, it actually makes a lot of sense because they're actually designed to put two in tandem. You stick them together, the inside will spin and the outside stay locked in place and nothing moves, which is really convenient for pump stuff. So that was really nice.
Yeah, so everything that we just kind of went through with the hydraulic design and the thermal expansion design, that's all under this path in the GitHub. There's documentation on how we did that, and there's spreadsheets to do the calculations again. They're just user input, spits out the answers. So that would be the place to start for the next people who are going to tackle this.
So,
is there any documentation through like just the fundamental equations that are being used that are outside of the spreadsheets? Because I've inherited spreadsheets
that
you just magically put in numbers.
That's why
they're super confusing in terms of trying to figure out what is this equation actually doing in an Excel spreadsheet?
Yeah.
So is there something else that just sort of explains, this is the theory that's going on behind the scenes of the spreadsheet?
Yeah, that's what the documentation is for. So the documentation is just...
In the documentation, sorry.
Yeah, it reads like a textbook. It's like, this is what's going on. This is how a pump works. These are the formulas. I don't think I have any actual calculations in this documentation.
Yeah,
the
formulas, you can look at the Excel spreadsheet at least, have some idea of what should be going on behind the scenes.
Yeah.
Doing it as opposed to just it's a black box, you put in some numbers, and something comes out
yes.
and you don't understand it. As somebody who's inherited one of these.
Yes, I inherited one of those too.
Yeah.
And this is exactly what I wish I would have had when I looked at, because mine was a Python script, and I had to decode what someone else was thinking in their brain. So I tried to write what my process actually was so someone else could.
Perfect.
There was some magical plus times two thing in there.
Yeah, there's some magical numbers that
weren't explained anywhere. Yeah.
Weren't explained anywhere. Yeah.
Like something is just times two for some reason, and the one right next to it is doing the exact same thing for a different fluid, but that was not times two. No idea why. But one of them was right.
I forgot that constant that I forgot to put the function we have there, so I'll put it all the way down. The
basically, yeah. Basically.
Hold on. So where is this?
So if you go to Flight Ready,
yep.
2.2 kilonewton, which should be the only one,
yep.
It's in the analysis folder.
You guys are liars.
So there should be one called...
design calculations?
Design calculation procedure or something.
Yep.
And there should be one called thermal expansion.
Written in LaTeX, we love you.
That's all, Phil. He's always LaTeX.
Oh, this is great. Oh my God, why didn't you write this first? Ha ha ha. Okay. This is great.
The design one for like the pump equations and everything, I did start that in fall term and it's been expanding since then. So.
Good.
Because if I didn't have that, I probably would have no idea how I got to the numbers that I got to. So that's what I wish I would have had at the beginning of this year. So
okay, great.
It's a good place for the next person to pick up from.
And the Excel spreadsheet is there too. This is great.
Yep.
Good.
And that, if you wanted to, is technically a black box. You enter your thrust, you enter all your things, and it spits out all your pump stuff. How much power you need, rotational speed, diameters, all of it.
This is great. So jerks like me can go in and design a 4 kilonewton, a 6 kilonewton, 8 kilonewton pump using the spreadsheet.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
And all the documentation for what those equations are doing, Phil has that on a separate document.
Awesome.
And they should all be in close proximity to each other.
Yep.
Okay.
Into manufacturing.
Yeah.
You guys want to come up? Swap these spots? Give
it. You want read shoes.
Hi. So my name is Juan Mendoza.
Hey. I'm Nick Sheldon.
And we're going to talk a little bit about manufacturing and some of the parts that we made here in house and what was our thought process and like maybe a little bit of the tooling, the fixture, and the machines that we use. So the first thing happened in fall term was a discussion of like, can we make all of these components here in the shop that PSU has for us? And so we look at the equipment that we have, and there are manual lathes, manual mills, and there is also one CNC vertical mill, and then one CNC open turning center. So that was enough for us to kind of evaluate the components that we had and see if we could make those. So obviously we decided, yes, we can do it. And we also look at the experience, previous experience that we had, other members of the team as well. So the first thing was, you know, deciding the material that we were going to try these toolpaths or these operations that we were going to do. So if you see on the pictures here, this is the part, this material, UHMW, this was perfect material because it was, you know, it was cheap. And it was also easy to machine, and it was also, you know, as far as dimension, when you machine it, it gives you good tolerance. So this allowed us to look at the toolpaths and see where we could save time, if we needed to, you know, machine it a different way, if we needed to buy different tooling. The shop that we have here, the tooling is limited, so I highly encourage to work in advance with Mike, the manager of the shop, and see what tools that he have that you can use and what other tools you need to buy ahead, because it will take some time.
So you guys bought tools using the UT grant?
Exactly, yes.
And then we left them in the shop, right?
Of course, yes. They're all in a box, and yeah, they're...
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, do we have them, or do we give them to Mike?
We'll bring them to, my understanding was we'll bring them up to PSS and PSS paper them.
Okay, all right.
But they're mostly, at this point, I think, just inserts and stuff. We didn't buy any like holders that would be specific to machines.
Okay.
Yeah. We say inserts for anything like that.
It's cutting inserts, and so you have a cutting tip on a rigid, for like the lathe, for example. It's like a small diamond insert that gets screwed in that you can use to cut different materials. So for this project, the shop already has holders for the lathe, some.
Yeah.
And so I bought inserts for that. And so I've only used one of like two. So there's a fresh one that he's asking to use for future projects that fits the lathe that we have here.
Can I request that if that goes into the PSAS stuff, there's some sort of documentation that goes along with it to say what it is? And
yeah,
like whether or not, you know, something that we can see and say, oh, this is a bat for somebody who doesn't know what they're looking at, and not just kind of go, oh, we don't know what this is, and then it gets moved somewhere else.
For sure. Yeah, I'll write down holder numbers and then insert numbers so that can be reordered as well in the future.
Awesome.
We also have material, extra material that definitely can be used. Yeah. Is there anything you want to add?
No, I think that was good. No. Yeah.
Cool. So this was one of the most challenging, well, not the most challenging, but it was a pretty cool part as we used both machines. We started with the lathe and then we continued on the mill. And we initially started with two different designs. We were, you know, debating whether it would be a good idea to have the shaft and the impeller together or connected with different a keyway or a pin or, you know, any other design that could work. And we decided that with the equipment that we had, this was the best. The best idea. So, Nick, if you can talk about that. Really.
Yeah, and that mostly got down to being just the best idea for complexity of manufacturing. And then I guess reliability would be a good word for that.
What was the idea?
Previous ideas, actually, I believe the past Capstone used a pin, so they had their shaft that was inserted into a hub on the back of the impeller. There was a cross hole drilled through both of those, and the pin was press fit into that. That was okay, but you have to have it tight, otherwise there's going to be a little bit of slop in there. So what we were looking at after that was doing a keyway. So you still have a hub, but now you've got a straight slot cut on the inside of that hub, and then a similar slot on the shaft, and you put a rectangular key that fits in between those. That's a good way of doing that. They're usually pretty efficient. However, to get the broaching equipment, which is how you cut the slots into a blind hole, not a through hole, would have been about $400 because the shop doesn't have holders. So that was inserts and holders and everything. So for testing a prototype, we didn't want to go that route. And so continue to look at different like mating options. It just seemed like there'd be inefficiencies and complexities of getting things to mate. So you're like, well, why don't we do it out of something that's just a single piece? Now you don't have to worry about power transmission from the shaft, none of that. And the added benefit of, since this whole component was turned on one machine in one operation, you have a much better chance of the shaft being perfectly concentric to the impeller. which is an added benefit for sure. So what we started here is we had 3-inch billet aluminum, threw it in the chuck, cut it down to size, did all the rough tuning here. This is the final taper of the impeller here, so that all that had to be done on the mill after the shaft was done.
Sorry, so you didn't use a cylinder, you actually used a piece, a chuck of 3-inch thick?
Excuse me, sorry, rod. It was a
cylinder. Oh, it was rod.
Yeah,
okay.
My bad, not billet. But yeah, so then moving on to here, so the mill. Loading it in, we're only having to worry about milling these toolpaths into vanes and then clearing out the center part there. And something that was important with all of these, if people do want to go down the route of manufacturing stuff again, is making sure everything is concentric. And so when we put this one in here, this is actually a chuck that we put in the mill here. And since before it was milled, it was round, we took a dial indicator that the shop has, and we swept it around to make sure that mill spindle was perfectly concentric to this part. Rather than just touching off on X and Y, you now confirm that 360 degrees is on center. And then over here, this right picture, we're actually just using an edge finder to touch off, and we put a small flat on that for the collar that Julio talked about earlier that sized up to the bearing. So that's about that.
I wanted to add for this, the chuck, so you're holding onto the shaft, and when you, the tooling that you have needs to be short fluted, because otherwise you'll have a lot of chatter and your surface finish, it'll be just ugly because you have a long tool and you're holding on to just the shaft and the web stands 3 inches, it'll just chatter and you'll have a bad finish and dimensionally not be as good. So yeah, number one, making sure it's concentric, dial indicator for sure. And then, you know, tooling, short flutes. We use high speed steel for tooling and we have one carbide for the finish pass, just to get a nice finish. So yeah, I wanted to show you the different tooling that we use. And so that was an example for the dial indicator, you know, finding the center of the hole. And that's the fixture, as you can see, that you have to add that to the table. It's not currently on the table. You have to add it. So next to it is the vise. And if for some reason, you know, someone takes the vise out and you need to put it back in, you would use the same dial indicator to make sure it's true to the machine. That's very, very important, especially if you're, you know, having parts being on the lathe and then bringing to the mill and then back to the lathe, you know, there's going to be some difference. So making sure it's true, very, very important. And so we used for on the impeller, we had a radius on the bottom, so we use a bull end mill or bull nose end mill with a small radius on the corner, as you can see on here, and that one. What I discovered, I ended up ordering tools because I wanted to machine the profile and at the same time also machine some of the bores. So I ended up getting this 3-inch, half-inch in diameter, 3-inch flute length. And what happened is the tool was too long to do the profile. And I actually ruined one of the parts because the surface was bad and then I cut too much into it. So I would highly encourage getting a longer diameter tools for the profile and for the roughing. And then a different tool, smaller diameter, longer flute length for just a single pass finish. It'll give you a better finish and it'll keep the dimensions within tolerance. This was some of the other inspection tooling that we use. If you have a bolt, for example, for the bearings and for the ground shoulder bores, you know, you can't use calipers or micrometers to measure the diameter. You need the telescoping gauges. So a lot of people don't know about those. So I highly encourage those for measuring inside diameters. Definitely don't trust the calipers.
Does Mike have those or?
Yes. Yeah. There's some.
That's, I guess, just something to note too, for any, I guess, capstones and, you know, dealing with this stuff. When you're working with high precision, you want to start checking things with micrometers over calipers because calipers can be pushed with pressure by your hand. So since we were dealing with a lot of like plus or minus a thousandth of an inch and then also dealing with concentricity measurements, micrometers, since they're geared, are going to be a lot more accurate for checking that. And so using telescoping gauges like that, you will get a couple thousandths of a difference when you're measuring. And so if you're dealing with the shafts and you're trying to size up collars and stuff to fit on that, we just recommend any teams going forward do their final measurements with micrometers or gauges like this, just to make sure you're in the ballpark there.
And it was just a great advantage to do it in-house, because, for example, when we were designing on SolidWorks, we would look up, let's say, the bearing, the diameter of the bearing on McMaster, and we would just grab that dimension, put it on SolidWorks, and then if you're outsourcing this part, you would send it out with that dimension, but you don't know what the real dimension is because you haven't gotten the part. You just look it up on McMaster. And then they make that part, you get it, and now you get your bearing, and now they're different. And now you just wasted this money, all this part. Versus making it in-house, waiting for the bearing to get it, I measure it, I machine it, and then I just adjust it accordingly to the actual part, and not what the file, not what the print on McMaster says. So it's one of the advantages of, you know, making this parts in-house.
So cost saving, you want to talk about that? So like, we ordered one case, you want to talk about that case we ordered versus how much it cost to do the rest of it?
Yeah, so towards May, we just decided that we were not going to have enough time to make the components to get the second pump for the cryo. And the component that we decided that was the most difficult or most challenging, because it started on the mill to do the profile, to do the threads, pipe threads, and then do this, and then the holes, and then this side to bring it to size, then goes to the lathe, and then the chamber, the chamber wall here is tapered, so that's why it needs to go to the lathe. And then it gets back into the mill for this hole right here and for the diffuser. So it was the most challenging part. We decided to, you know, have somebody else do it. And I think it cost $500?
About that.
$500.
For one piece.
For just one piece. Now, you can imagine if, you know, you make a mistake and, you know, something was wrong, or you decided to change something last minute because it didn't work out. Well, now you're... can't change that, because now it's done and it's $500. So definitely it's an advantage in as far as the cost to make the parts here in house. And also by, you know, trying it first, you know, this was started with this. This material was given to me. It was free. And I tested everything, mostly everything. So we actually didn't make any mistakes on the other parts, like bad. You know, to start a new part mistake. That's what I'm saying. So,
I think moving forward, though, definitely recognizing that not every group of features necessarily going to be doing their own manufacturing. Just in hindsight, I would encourage our design phase went on for about two terms and then ongoing there. And of course, you can't get away from adjusting on the fly. Like, there were things that came to light when we would assemble.
But
yeah.
We just pause for a second.
I have it here. Keep going.
Okay, thanks.
Awesome. So, you know, once you assemble things and you're like tinkering with it there and you have your hands on it, you can kind of recognize some things that need to be adjusted. Aside from those little learning experiences, I would just recommend groups to do as much as they can in CAD, which isn't going to always be a perfect prediction of what's going to happen. But getting parts, like Hanas was talking about, like ordering bearings from McMaster, like once you have your design figured out, and like, okay, I'm pretty sure we want to use this. If you don't have the ability to make stuff on your own, I would recommend ordering those components that you do plan on putting in before you send out machining requests, so that you can change your CAD just size up to the model there. It'd probably be the easiest workaround.
So how much CAD experience did you guys have before this adventure?
I did it for about 4 years in the industry.
Yeah, me too.
Okay, so you guys were totes pros.
I mean, not pros, but I mean, we do.
We could fit it.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yes,
okay.
Yeah. And all the files, so for the CAD, you know, we use SolidWorks. For the CAM, we use MasterCAM, which is available in the shop. And all the files are available. And I usually put notes on every toolpath of what that toolpath did. So I try to do an okay job of describing each operation.
That's great.
Where are the MasterCAM files on GitHub?
Yeah, not on
GitHub. I don't know if we have those yet.
Not on GitHub yet. Yes.
But they will be on GitHub.
They will be.
They will be.
They will be.
Excellent. Good job. Where are they right now?
On two different computers.
Yes.
Yeah, you're fired. Okay.
But they will be pulled.
Good. All right, good.
Yep. We also wanted to talk about the importance of having drawings, because from the past Capstone, we didn't get any drawings. Now, well, I mean, yeah, you can say, well, the parts were different and that doesn't matter. But for example, and we wanted to look at some of the connections, the pipe threads, and instead of trying to figure out the actual part and measure it, you know, you can just look up the print, look at the callout, and save yourself some time. So we did, as an example, we did this print, because this was the part that we were gonna have made for us, and we'll definitely have prints for the other components.
Good, so all components will have prints checked in the GitHub.
Yep.
Good job.
And there's a note on that too. Typically, when you're sending stuff out, a print is gonna trump the CAD file with most companies. So it's good just to make sure this is what you want it to be rather than sending a solid model only. Cool.
And now the fun stuff.
Do you guys want to do results?
Oh wait, you're not done.
So
so go back a couple slides. Keep going. Was there one more? Right. Nope. Back to the first one. So you guys had already used MasterCAD.
I'd used similar programs instead of learning MasterCAD.
I had previous experience with MasterCAD.
And what did it take for you to get Mike's trust to use the mills, the machines, centers?
I think what he's mostly concerned about is just that you're not going to do anything unsafe in there.
Okay.
And now with CNC machines, there's the added complexity of it being robotic,
right?
So you can hurt yourself in different ways, and you can also cause more expensive crashes. And so I think trust there was him knowing just we had experience on CNC machines, but I think moving forward, for anyone else in there, one, just knowing how to safely work in a machine shop in general is a big plus, and that's what he's looking for mostly. And then I think taking someone who can go slowly learning a CNC machine, I think you can learn it for sure in the shop here with the tools that are available. It just takes someone double-checking their work before they just hit go on something, right? Just being careful. I think if he sees that, I think he'll work alongside it pretty well.
And definitely don't show up the first week of a spring term, like trying to start making things on spring term. Like I remember I talked to him on September, it was the first week of our Capstone because we knew we were gonna make things. And I went to him and I said, this is what we're gonna do. So have plenty of time to, to you know, talk to him and tell him what your plan is and also to practice and have.
Right.
Good.
Oh yes.
Yeah, cleaning.
Yeah,
yes. Mike
clean
will,
the shop.
Mike will, yeah.
Yes, please clean the shop because he will let you know if you did not clean that shop.
Yep.
That's his big rule.
Yeah, results.
Thanks.
Thank you.
So this is results. This is the slide that I got to play. This is the, so, this is the IPA pump first test for records. This was back in April, early April. So you'll notice that it sounds very much like a pump, and for good reasons. This first test was the very first time we put this pump together, and we had everything set up the way we wanted to. We had our gauges, we had our flow meter, we had all the electronics proofed, we had everything set and ready to go. We just finally had components, we assembled them, we made a procedure, and we executed that procedure. Things we didn't account for starting, you'll notice there's a towel here. That's because our water lines finally started leaking, even after hours and hours of thermal testing the system, not getting a single water leak. On test day, the line started leaking. And for this first test, we're pretty sure that the way we had the controller set up down here, that water got into the circuit board and fried it. So that sort of chunking sound, we have a feeling was it trying to turn the poles, and it's not getting a consistent signal. So it was jumping and jumping and jumping in between the poles. Because again, that thing this little controller, all it does is it just sends two poles current and two poles off, two poles current and two poles off. And that's how it rotates. So if it's not getting a consistent signal, you get that sort of chunky sound. And you'll notice, I can play it again.
So that wasn't aluminum on aluminum, it rubbing. You think that was the
motor?
That
was the motor. That was the motor sound. So there was the first time we actually, this is the second time we ran it. The first time we actually spun this thing, we did actually get metal on metal inside of there. But that was very quickly turned off, and we realized it was because we incorrectly gapped the impeller. There was a lot wrong with this design when we first tried it just because of alignment issues. And there's only, inside this case, you'll notice there's a bunch of Sharpie in there. That was how we were identifying where we were getting rubbing. And the way this impeller and this case mate, the very outer edges will touch first before the entire face. So that the angles are not exactly identical, they're off by about half a degree. And that was sort of more of a chance, but it actually worked out in our favor because we were able to get grinding at the very ends and it wasn't just destroying the thing because it was just a very small surface area contact. But we heard that right away, turned it off. We sharpied it, Nick actually hand filed the impeller, this beautifully machined impeller. He took a hand file and just wore off the edges. And it got us clearance, but the second test had other issues when we ran through it.
Play it again.
So if you play it again, if you watch the water flow, you'll notice not much.
Then it dies.
And then it just kind of stops. And even as it spins, that never changes.
Yeah.
So the reason I'm thinking that was this is that this was spinning, but that impeller was barely moving, which makes me think that all that chunking was just inside of the motor, getting this very strange signal to just basically very erratically move. So if that impeller had actually been spinning at the throttle that I had that set at, that water should have moved out. You should have seen something happen, but nothing happened to that water. So it makes us think that nothing actually happened inside of the pump, and it was just basically
okay.
So
if the impeller is not moving at all,
it was moving, but just not.
But if it wasn't moving at all,
yes,
would we still have water flow?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, everything moves completely around it. All the impeller does is it pushes the water. That's how you prime a pump. So there's air inside of the pump, so you turn the water on, and you should get a nice little flow of water running through everything, and no air. And once you turn it on, that's when you start getting pressure coming out of the pump. But the fact that we didn't see anything makes me think that it was just kind of doing this, which you can see if you look. It's kind of hard to see in this resolution, but you can see the coupler go like this, where it's oscillating back and forth. And that is basically the controller frying itself to death. So
it's there's something called sensorless commutation, where there's no sensor on the motor that's showing you where it is.
Mm-hmm.
So it's trying to figure out where the motor is to energize the right coils at the right time.
Perfect.
And so if it doesn't do that, that's bad.
Yeah.
And was that a bad connection? Or do you think that was the water?
No, that was in here. So the basically this is set up two wires for live current, and then it has three wires that go out to the motor. The water failure was right at the motor plugs. So it was frying those exits. So the current that would switch the poles, that's where we got smoke. So my thought is that it was trying to turn, and if one of those three fried, it was sending two of three, and the motor had no idea what was going on because the timing was just completely off by the poles. So essentially we took a lot of lessons learned sort of from this, a lot of redesign, and just a lot of trying to figure out where to go from there with this system. So,
No, I mean, there was definitely some alignment issues as well. Which came up in our redesign for the cryo case, which is the stuff we're talking about, bearings and seal. We had to change out the seal regardless because it wasn't going to work for the cryo. But we don't think it did us any favors with alignment on the IPA test, so I think removing that was something that helped with our alignment. And the motor mounts were also redesigned by Nick pretty close to the last minute.
Yeah,
he just threw out a new mounting concept, new design, got it machined in less than a week.
Two days.
It was quick. So you'll notice if you look in there, you'll notice that the motors are directly bolted to the casing. Before, what we had here is we had two separate mounts that mounted like this. So the motor was not technically concentric apart from this tolerancing on a non-machined piece. So even though this was super sweet and precise, and the pump was super precise, it was mounted on something that was just 1/8 inch aluminum that was welded and flexed. So when we lined it up, we didn't think that was gonna be that big of an issue because we had a flex coupler, but it was. Because when you're talking tolerances that much, if it binds even a little bit and it wobbles, that thing's just gonna jam and it doesn't want to go anywhere and it totally goes pop. So that was something to consider. And then that solid, yes.
We need to finish that thought.
So basically going forward, bolt that motor directly to that pump.
Go back to the drawing of the LOX pump that you have way back in the beginning. That, so that's the new...
This is the new one. This is the final one that we ended up using.
Okay.
This is the new guy.
Okay, and did you machine that out of a solid piece of aluminum?
Which part?
This guy,
the bracket?
Yes.
That was all one piece.
Cool.
One big cube turned into a bunch of pockets.
And it was also a lot less material in the end, too.
Yeah.
Just an extra bonus.
Thanks.
And then... So this is the cryo one. This is basically, again, our super last-minute test. But all the lessons learned from the first one.
So at the beginning of that test, was that air or?
That was just the inlet pressure of the tank. So there inside of the little, I'm calling it potato, is liquid nitrogen at 50 PSI.
Okay.
And when it exits through,
you'll
notice, again, it's very quick and short, but you'll notice as it's exiting, it changes velocity once Henry turns the pump on. So we are actually moving fluid. So I can replay that again.
Yeah.
Again, I wish we had more nitrogen through it because we ran out.
So right there is just pressure.
That's just pressure and it's mostly gas. After he turns it on, you'll notice that gets a lot more white and that's actual fluid moving through it. So when we turn it on, it's just pressure running through the system and then by that point, we're basically running out of nitrogen because it drained it so fast.
What is the thing that...
After basically we ended the
tank. Okay.
So there's still mostly when you start hearing that chugging, that's mostly gas.
And one reason why it might be doing that, the chugging is a good report, you're seeing it alternate between a jet and then gas and jet gas, is that we realistically probably didn't have the NPSH like we were talking about before.
Yeah.
Our net pressure suction head probably wasn't spot on, especially without pressure gauges. There's really no way to tell. But if your pump is trying to pull the fluid and it's not being fed at the pressure that the pump geometries want it to come at, it's going to start cavitating. So it's going to start spitting out gas.
For people who are EEs and not mechanicals, cavitation is when you have a fluid turn into a gas because of a lack of pressure. So it gets to a point where it's at such a low pressure, it instantly vaporizes. Then it fixes itself, and then it goes back into liquid, and then vaporizes. And basically, you get this cycle where the pressure is constantly changing in the inlet of the pump. And that was when we're running out of fluid, and again, we had no idea what pressure we were really feeding it, other than the top gauge I was getting from my compressor told us 50. But as it's leaving, you're losing that pressure, and that compressor was not keeping up with how fast that pump was pushing things out of.
Your compressor does not keep up with the speed that
it doesn't.
Was the whole system at, I'm guessing, 50 PSI?
50.
50. Oh,
50 PSI.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, there's a lot of drop pressure on that one.
Yeah, it's super fast. So that
even
was
on the
whole
pintle test, you dropped 20 PSI just right on
that.
And that was extremely low flow rate.
Yeah.
Good.
So.
Couple dumb questions. How did you know it was at 50 PSI?
50 PSI, so there's a regulator up here,
uh-huh,
which I had set to 50, and there's a second regulator on my compressor, which was also set to 50.
Okay,
yeah,
so you had an air pressure, a little pump, electric pump air compressor that was pressurizing that to 50 PSI.
Yep.
That was pushing the the liquid nitrogen down through the pump, which is that when you undid it, that was the first stream we saw.
Yep.
Then you turned on the
then we turned on the pump.
Okay. And then you think you didn't have enough NPSH, so you were getting cavitation, which is why we were seeing the chuffing.
The chuffing.
Okay.
Yeah, and it could be that, and it could just be a mix of the air and the liquid nitrogen.
Because it could be sloshing around in there or something.
Yeah, we didn't have, at that point, this was actually the second time that we didn't do I wouldn't consider it a full test, but we did try running it before everything had cooled to the level that it was now cooled at.
Mm-hmm.
And on that test, it was just gas. It just was like...
That at the time, we just attributed to it, oh, it's just not ready. Because we kept checking. Like, we kept trying to push fluid through and see if we could get fluid out, and it just wasn't coming out. So we're like, it's still got to get colder. If we had another way to also measure thermal stuff when we're doing this, that would be really helpful as well, because that thing's got to get so cold to get started. Because otherwise, as soon as that liquid nitrogen hits, and it's not anywhere near below minus 300, it's just going to flash, and you have no liquid anyway running through that thing. So it's got to get super cold.
Dumb last question. Can you run that pump all day long with air at regular temperatures?
Air? Or
no.
Air, no. It has to be liquid.
What if it's just air?
It doesn't do anything. It doesn't do anything.
So it's fine.
No.
The point is that...
Oh, I see. Yes, yeah.
If
you wanted to, you could run it with air, but that barrier is going to get real hot real fast.
Yeah, I would say that a lot of things are going to get real hot real fast.
Yeah.
Okay.
I wouldn't recommend it.
Okay.
At those RPMs.
Water would be fine to run all day.
Water
will
be fine once we had a proper seal, because otherwise that's going to leak and you're just going to fry that motor underneath it.
Right.
So, but yes. Sorry. In that sense, no, you can't run it all day.
Leaking is going to be an issue, would it be possible to switch the orientation and have the motor on top so that we were not accidentally leaking in the side of a rocket, having the motor underneath where it might leak?
No, because the motor is directly in line and the fluid is directly in line. So now you're having to push fluid around.
Right, right. I have it this way. Is there
already and a half runs on the outside of the rocket?
Well,
use a standoff.
Because right now it's oriented vertically. So continuing to have it oriented vertically, but sticking the motor where it's less likely to be leaked on by a leaky seal or LOX and IPA.
But then you'd have to take a U-turn.
Yeah, we'd
I don't think you can.
I think we'd be increasing our losses a lot.
Okay.
Because we'd be coming, regardless,
so the seals are critical
here, so we'd have to come this way, this way, this way, and back out this way.
They're critical anyway.
If we're leaking water, then we're leaking liquid oxygen because it's harder to seal. And then
that's my point. If we're leaking liquid oxygen on things that are not oxygen safe, that'd be an issue.
Is that problem significant enough to mitigate, to seek mitigating it in other ways than just putting in the correct seal? So obviously do that, but then any other thing
like
that we need to do. There are other things you should
bag or something.
So the way, I can say, an industry person we talked to, the way they do it is there's two separate sort of combatants to that. One is a recycle, so you have a port machined into the seal housing, where you're actually pumping any leaks that gets past it back into the pump chamber. And that's done with having vanes on the back of the impeller. And so you get this sort of suction inside of the pump. So anything that does get past the seal, in theory, gets pulled back in. So it never makes it outside of the pump. That's one thing. That's a machining thing that we have to design to figure out how we would even make that. The second thing is you have basically a helium purge in there, where you basically keep inputting a gas in there doesn't allow it to leave. I'm not 100% sure on that, but when we were talking to him, he said that was the second option to have, but I haven't personally looked into that part. The cycle thing I think is the easiest, just because if anything gets past it, you now have a suction on the outside of the seal that's constantly pulling things back in into the chamber and not actually leaving into the motor and all that other stuff. Because flipping that orientation, I can't even actually picture how that works.
Okay.
Any more questions on crowd stuff?
Yeah.
Yes.
So for like the test, would it be pre-chill and then maybe try ice first to at least get clear and not run as much LOX?
That came up in the meeting. For LOX, yes, because that would be much more expensive. This nitrogen, 30 pounds was $30. So for us, as far as cooling it, in this case, liquid nitrogen is actually the most cost effective. For LOX, I don't know what the pricing on that is, but that might be something to think about. But maybe in that case, you just cool it with liquid nitrogen, purge it with liquid nitrogen anyway, and then run liquid oxygen through it as a secondary test. Because liquid nitrogen, at least by the SRTC price, is super cheap. It's $1 a pound.
Well,
that whole test costs $30.
The smallest they'll sell us of LOX is generally 150 liters, which is considerably more than we're actually going to use for a test.
So then,
that'll sell it.
So then I guess in that case, you would just show with what you have since you already paid for it.
Since we talked about it, talk about the dripping liquid nitrogen versus something else.
In terms of?
We were talking about putting in a thing to keep the liquid in there instead of draining it out.
Oh, so yes. So one of the problems we ran into with cooling is that you'll notice at this very end, it's completely open. So there's no valve or anything. So when you open this tank to start leaking liquid nitrogen, to start cooling everything, the nitrogen was just kind of leaving and then vaporizing into the atmosphere. Where if you had something at the very far end to stop it, in theory, you could drop liquid nitrogen and then it stays in there and starts cooling everything much faster.
Like a main cool valve?
And you're not losing any nitrogen just cooling it to the air. Because we spent a lot of time just dripping nitrogen through it to cool it down. Where if that was closed at the end, in theory, that whole thing is now a liquid nitrogen reservoir. And then you can just open that and then start running it through and then turn your pump on. And it cools it much faster. Also, as Jacob mentioned in the meeting, insulate all of this because this was all exposed to air. So we were losing, and the lines were stainless, but the pump is aluminum. So it's pulling out a whole bunch of heat through convection and conduction. So we lost a lot of heat just going that route. So putting a valve at the very end and then insulation would have been huge for that as well. And then again, just having some way to actually measure the temperature. Once we're at, you know, minus 315, we know we're close and we can start testing to see where we're at as opposed to just something.
If you're actually closing the liquid nitrogen in there, just make sure you're able to gas off the pressure.
Yes, that's another thing.
Just to add to that, at the 200 Kelvin difference in temperatures, you're actually also receiving a ton of ether radiation.
Oh, yeah, for sure, as well.
Just to make sure it's all that.
Definitely.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, radiation's a good.
So we need to. Sorry. So do we need big styrofoam blocks to put these things in?
We could. That would be really cool. If we could cut some foam or something to go around
it.
Like just some custom shaped stuff would be really nice. We may have to redesign the mount because there's not, unless you like completely encase the whole thing, at the moment there's only a way to get to the front of it so you can't actually get to the back of it.
Spray and foam.
But so, yeah, you could literally do that and that would be better than what we did. So just have something. But that might take a little bit more redesign, and that into the airframe assembly, that may be something to think about where the pumps are sort of mounted in sort of this floating position that way you can actually wrap around the whole thing. But
although in the airframe they are gonna be in their own enclosed space, so I think that the low temperatures of liquid nitrogen are gonna be a little bit more trapped. It's not gonna be as affected by an external environment. So
insulation.
Yeah.
Yeah, oh absolutely. Absolutely is.
If anything in the actual circumstance we're designing it for putting it in the rocket module, we might be worried about too much low temperature, honestly. If we're having the control components and the motor and all this stuff very close proximity to these things that are getting ridiculously cold, I would be insulating to protect that stuff from getting too cold, honestly.
That was another, thank you. Remember, so that's when I kind of laughed when we said that there was a cooling system. You only need to cool one of these guys.
Yeah.
That motor and that ESC was freezing. So there was water leakage on the wood of this, and that was frozen on the wood. I mean, this thing got super cold. So as Phil was saying, at this point, one pump we're insulating to keep the motor just alive. Because if it's in there for hours at this point, we let it cool down after a while, or I guess in our case, warm back up after a while. But that's something to consider, these damages, because we're cooling these well past where the manufacturer says they should be for cooling side of things. So that was something to consider, because even the water inside of that was starting to freeze. So the water is not enough to actually combat the liquid nitrogen. So you can't even, unless you pumped hot water through it. We didn't try hot. We were just having garden hose room temperature water. But now one side is acting as a coolant where the other side is acting as a heater. But I don't think it's enough to keep up with, especially liquid nitrogen, liquid oxygen. You're just not going to heat that up enough. And even with that running at full amperage, those wires were freezing enough to transfer the heat. Because the only thing transferring heat to that ESC was through the wires that had current through them, and it was still freezing. So it was pretty cold.
That's cool.
Yes, Mark.
You say you're using one of the motors as a heater and the other one as a
No, no, sorry.
Okay.
One motor.
Not intentionally.
Cool.
Which I guess
have a recirculation.
If you did, if you
yeah.
cycled, if you cycled, connected the cooling systems from one to the other, then I guess in theory you're balancing it out better. But that, the with how close that motor is, especially if we do their onboarding design, which you'll see, which has a connected shaft, that motor is even closer to the chamber, and it's going to get even colder. So I don't think
would it be possible to get insulation, like a decent amount of insulation between the housing and the motor?
Well, you can, but the shaft
the
is
shaft,
what's
yeah,
bringing everything, and that's directly connected.
Yeah.
You can't get out of that unless you did a carbon fiber shaft, which would be pretty
right.
expensive.
So you're going to have reduction through the shaft itself, but you can insulate between everything else at least to
slow it down.
Yeah.
If we had a bunch more money and time, you could do magnetic coupling, which would be pretty baller, but that's a whole other monster in itself. So onboarding stuff. Your sort of seals?
Yeah, so we've been talking about the seals a good amount already. Long story short, whenever EFS 3 happens, don't go down the route with bellow seals. We strongly advise against it. It's just not the right selection for this application. We came to the decision of Teflon spring energized seals. We actually were going to run our crowd tests if we were able to procure these in time, but we weren't able to. They're a little bit harder to get a hold of. There are a few specific companies. Parker is one of them. Parker Seals, and there's another one I've written down, but I don't remember off the top of my head. But we would recommend pursuing one of those companies. It's similar to the Boca bearings, where you kind of have to contact a salesperson, tell them what your application is. They'll try to help you size and select the right seal. And we didn't have the time for that. This was 3 weeks ago. Ironically, I was actually looking at our original build materials
yep.
from our UT proposal, and that was the seal that I put on.
And we never got a chance to execute it.
That's painful.
Then we walked away from it, and now we're back at it.
I don't understand. I understand how the bellows pack seal works. The spring presses that black face against
yes.
the thing
yeah.
that rotates. I don't understand how the energized seal works. Can you explain that?
I meant to put an image in here, but I think I forgot to.
I think it is, but yeah, it only gets in there, but it's pretty cool.
So this configuration isn't exactly what we would be using. This is just the best picture I could find of one.
Okay.
So what we would be looking at is something the Teflon is similar, but it has a spring that's being clamped this way, so it's not like a coil spring. It's
like a
spring-loaded
spring. Okay.
Yeah.
Keep
talking. Yeah. So I'll just use my hands.
Yes, please.
So this is pushing up against this Teflon seal.
Yep.
And as your pump builds pressure, the fluid's going to push into the spring and make the spring want to open up even more, which is just improving your sealing forces more and more. So the more pressure you build, the better seal you're going to get.
It's a U-shaped ring.
Yes.
That goes around, and does either side, the spring itself, the seal itself does not rotate.
The seal itself does not rotate. It's just PTFE making contact with the shaft.
And so, it's on the shaft.
And as it expands, it basically squeezes onto the shaft.
It squeezes onto the shaft
as the pressure is building up
mm-hmm.
because of the deformation.
Yeah. That. There it is. That's what my hand is doing.
That's
right
helpful.
Here.
Which part is rotating?
This right here. So this is the
This
center
is
line, this is rotating.
Oh, so you're literally rubbing.
It's Teflon.
Yeah.
So it doesn't
yes.
wear very much. So the inside, this spins and just wears. That doesn't.
Okay.
So, and as the fluid pushes in, it just makes it even harder, and it pushes as hard as it can. So.
For the record, Gallagher was the other company I couldn't think of.
There we go.
Gallagher seals.
Okay.
Gallagher seals.
So sorry. So the fluid and the impeller is on the right in this picture.
Yeah. So the motor is right here.
Yeah.
Shaft
okay.
and then impeller that way.
Okay, thank you.
So yeah, fluid is going this way and then. Yeah. I knew we had that in the report. That's in the report that you get from us later.
Yay.
And that's on GitHub already too, that report.
Okay.
You want to talk about bearings?
Sure. Bearings, so sort of sum it up. Go with ceramic if you can, just for thermal contraction stuff, and they don't require any lubrication. So as far as excess So when you have a stainless bearing, especially for the IPA pump, you usually have some lubricant inside it, just regular pack bearing stuff. But if you can get away with ceramic, you just submerge that in the fluid, and that's enough for these things to survive, especially at these high RPMs. As long as the fluid is completely encasing it, it actually survives really well. And having the bearing in the front of the seal is really helpful, rather than having components that are rotating super fast outside of the seal. It just makes the design a lot more simple, because then in that case, you can do the same design we did for the cryo one for both pumps, which is, we at this point, we know work if we could get a seal that to finish.
So let me see if I got this then. So it's impeller on the left, mm-hmm. followed by the ceramic bearing.
Two of them.
Two of them.
Two bearings.
So yeah, two bearings. We had one ceramic, one stainless steel. Ideally, it would be two ceramics.
Two ceramics.
Okay, but you have, but then the seal comes between the two bearings, right?
Seals at the end.
So the bearings are in with the fluid itself.
So impeller?
Yep.
Bearing?
Yep.
Bearing, seal.
Okay. And then would they be the exact same bearing or what's going to
be? Yeah, if we could get two of these bokas and stick them together, that'd be perfect.
Okay.
Because again,
don't need a thrust bearing for this.
They're both thrust bearings. If you pull it, you can pull these apart into three pieces, and the balls just get crushed into these little channels.
Yeah.
And that's where it's supposed to design take force. You have to push them against each other in order for them to work.
Okay.
And so the way these are, the outer races, it allows the inner ones to spin without contact.
Okay.
That's how that works. Okay. You just have something inside that transfers the force to this.
Okay.
That's all.
And they also have similar bearings, but the outer races are ceramic and the inside rollers are stainless steel.
Yeah. Yeah, make those as well.
Those are also looks compatible.
The key for the ceramic part is when you have the bore of the chamber and it's cooling down, if you have something that's cooling at a different rate, you risk tolerancing being an issue. But since, for this case, since they're contracting, it's not as bad, especially if you have an aluminum case pressing on stainless. The stainless isn't going to go as much, so you're actually just clamping out even more. But with ceramics, it's just, you just get that out because the ceramic doesn't want to move. Even at cryo temperatures, it doesn't move noticeably at all. And that's within plus or minus a thousandth. You don't even see that much at these cryo temperatures. So they're just really nice to have that part just kind of nixed out of your equation, which is always helpful.
Hey, you mentioned that they don't like changing temperature. How is the temperature change from 90 Kelvin to room temperature? Like, do they define on that? Or
that's in cold. So in compression, they're fine. When you're cooling things down super fast, that's not a problem.
Warming up after the fact, like after it's you know, done speaking of liquid oxygen, it's not going to be warming up at room temperature.
Yes, that, as far as we know, that survived at that thermal rate. But again, that was pretty slow.
Yeah, we just let it sit for a couple hours.
That was pretty slow.
Okay.
My only concern of the oven was that it was going to go up
too
pretty fast, because you're going up a couple hundred degrees in a few minutes, where that took a long time to come down.
Talking about going up to 100 degrees, going up a couple hundred.
That was just my concern with that, with the heating element. But
yeah,
for thermal stuff, these are fine. And these are also more designed for thermal stuff in the cold sense, not in the heat sense, which is why I'm like, that's outside of what they're rating.
And then just on the inner diameter of the inner race, no issues with that tolerance with the aluminum shaft?
Nope. That one was, these were actually pretty well to manufacture spec.
Even under
they
current
were,
conditions.
Yeah, they're really good.
The inner race of the bearing wasn't actually making contact with the shaft. There's a collar in there that you can't see in that cross section.
If we could take that thing apart, we would, but it's press fit on together, so it kind of is what it is.
Yeah, so that was Teflon, so yeah.
You want to talk about weight reduction? That was all you.
Cool case. Yeah, I mean, this is the progress of our making the pump somewhat more flight ready in terms of weight. This is the first guy. Tons of wasted space, tons of material that was totally unnecessary. Mounts, which we found out were unnecessary, packed down into, I would say probably a third of the weight. We didn't actually calculate that, but that's what I would guess. And this is just some concept CAD moving forward of additional weight that can be removed, probably another quarter or third of the weight on these cases that will not affect performance whatsoever.
So the way Bill did the weight reduction is that this is our exact pump, but in all the spots where aluminum isn't doing anything, it's gone. So the only thing that's needed for something like this, though, is somebody needs to genuinely do some FEA analysis on that. Because now, when we designed that, we didn't even bother because there's so much wall thickness all over this thing. We knew it wasn't going to damage anything. But once you're starting getting down, now you're optimizing weight to strength. So you're getting down to the strength to weight ratio of aluminum and you're pushing it. But to find that, you need that. Because otherwise, you're carrying things up that you don't have to. Or if you can shave down as much of that design as possible without changing the internals, because that's done. But you can get rid of a bunch of weight that isn't really doing anything in that sense. But again, that adds a lot more machining time. So it's something to consider to make sure that it's optimized for both machining cost and then weight reduction as well. That's something to think about for the next one as well. And then you want to talk about the motor?
Sure. Oh, yeah.
So that's a little different.
That's a big decision moving forward. We've been talking about just our overall design and how this cryo test went and how we would move forward if we got to keep working on it. And something we've considered is if you're able to procure a motor with an extended shaft, not super long, probably about 2.5 to 3 inches, and then you take the original traditional route of mounting an impeller on a hub into the shaft, then you would be able to remove this entire section right here. So the motor is actually flush up right here. You can sort of tell. So it's just removing another redundancy if possible. And I would say the biggest thing to consider with that is if temperature is going to be getting scary for that motor at that point. For the
That's something that is
going to
be think about.
It's going to be really cold. But that is, I think, something for the next EFS team to seriously consider looking into is completely removing the need for a coupler, taking out 2 inches of the design, taking this step that we did, bringing this in here, and just taking it one step further, putting the motor directly into the pump.
And the problem with that then is that you have to really worry about the fact that your impeller has to be mounted correctly to your shaft.
So with that sense, you would, if we had to recommend, you do the traditional keyway because it is the most traditional for most pumps. They always have a keyway, but again, you just need to buy some equipment for it, to at least to do it here. Otherwise, you could just get it sent out and someone with broaching equipment could do it for you. Because again, this isn't a through hole that you could just machine an entire slot through. You have to stop,
right,
which is difficult because now you're pushing metal and it has nowhere to go. Where a regular broach, you could just keep punching it through and it just, little by little, you push it all the way through till you cut your slot. Where in this case, it has to stop. So you have, it's much more difficult to broach something that isn't all the way through.
But effectively, you're taking the imperfections and concentricity that you get from using a coupler and just scooting it up the shaft of the impeller.
That's it.
And you're having less actual rotating length overall, so the minimal deflection that might be there should be less.
I think if you could try to manage something like this, if when you got to this point, if you're getting a motor with a custom shaft anyway, just find one that can handle those temperatures, that has maybe in itself has ceramic bearings inside of it and could somehow do it. If we spend the money to get this setup custom, let's just buy some proper motors that can survive that.
It also be looked at, like, just doing some tests on just water heating it well to see if it.
And we could,
that,
but
that
again, it's a lot of energy.
Yeah.
That thing gets super cold. Like, you need some really hot water moving a lot of energy back into it. But then at that point, if this thing is super hot in itself and it's that close, now you're also putting energy into there and it's going to start cavitating in the back.
The coils don't care about the cold. Only the bearings do.
So then, okay.
And
that's
so
cool.
If we could go in and actually replace that, people open up and you know, pimp my electric motor all the time.
Awesome.
In this case, we could do it by replacing the standard bearings with ceramic bearings.
That would be cool. Because these are just Japanese stainless steel bearings. These are the ones at least. That would be awesome.
I don't know if we'll ever be able to afford a custom motor like that. They tend to be extremely expensive.
Yeah.
We'll probably be stuck with the coupling forever, but that's would be a really nice idea.
Cool.
So if it's possible to open those, though. Like
we
were saying, we were just kind of wondering that you can actually get into motors like that without damaging them. We didn't try. You could do the impeller design and then just plug the impeller to the motor.
Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, the problem is you can't take the shaft off.
Oh.
The shaft is part of the
magnets and stuff.
Assembly.
Gotcha.
The bearings you can press out and redo, but you can't replace the main rotor.
We're not super far from the length of, I don't remember where this motor even came from, but I think they had it up to like 2 inches, right? For the shaft.
Oh, this is TB power. Yeah, it's close. The shaft doesn't need to be that much longer.
Okay.
It really doesn't need to be that much longer. It just wasn't.
Is that something that could be like potentially welded onto the end and then machined down?
I would be concerned because unless you welded it, I'd be concerned. Because
yeah,
when you have an end and you put heat on the other end, it's going to move. And that thing's got to be super concentric. So if you have a thing that's wobbling at 30,000 RPM, you're just going to vibrate yourself to death. So we're not trying to make a shaker table. I know Orsa needs a shaker table, but it doesn't need to be this.
Thank you.
So airframe.
Would you airframe?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's all kind of a given. We have this nice little box it fits in that should fit within the 12-inch module, but someone is going to have to figure out how that actually mounts into the rocket itself. And then, like we kind of touched on earlier, we're going to have to deal with the plumbing out of this thing because this fits into the rocket, but we have flow coming out right here, and that immediately has to go somewhere. So I didn't realize that plumbing could potentially leave the airframe. Is that what you said?
Mm-hmm.
Not any. It's complicated if you're using them as we originally planned, which I think is, so if nothing changed, then they'll still be under the tanks. That plumbing will not be coming out.
Okay, then I'll say what I was going to say, which is that this is going to have to make a 90 degree turn.
Real fast.
Pretty much immediately. Because
it looks like there's plenty of space for a normal pipe bed.
Yeah.
Which it can, it's just that's something to consider.
Yeah,
that's another huge
those
loss.
Flow losses into consideration.
Is there any way to put them slightly cockeyed to give you just a little bit more space? Slightly off? Because right now they're both completely vertical.
If you shorten them, I think you could. If you shorten them and then brought it in a little bit, I think you could get around to where now the piping has to go like this and the motors have to go like that.
Well, if they're slightly, if you move them slightly to their slightly different heights, slightly angled.
Yeah,
again, that comes down to the inlet tubing,
yeah.
And now the back of the motor.
The inlet tubing is easy to bend.
But again, you have a full length now, because now you're taking something that's in line that was never, it's long, and you're turning it, maybe. I don't know, I didn't measure anything for that,
yeah.
So I couldn't tell you off the top of my head.
It didn't have to be steep,
well,
we just need a little bit of space.
So one of the benefits of the fact that we're going to have that external routing is that we could actually have it coming directly from the external routing to the module. So that whole module could potentially be at an angle if that's something that helps us out. But
yeah.
So we have a lot of freedom with it right now, and constraints aren't really there yet.
What's the actual measurement on that box?
That is 6.5 by 10 rectangle.
Oh, okay.
The diameter of that
those
is
the
size for an LV4. This way is like 11.8-ish, which is right inside of where we were.
So that whole box would actually fit in the LV4 airframe.
This was our fake LV4. It doesn't quite fit because the hinges actually mess it up, but this is some Honda Civic grade carbon fiber, which is just a sticker. And that is essentially how we did our showcase, where this opened up and the pump opened up. But that's LV4. That's our module. But it does, it fits inside the 12-inch airframe.
Okay, thanks.
And if you did go the route of offsetting them vertically, then you could even bring that rectangle.
That is well.
Yeah.
We had that actually at first.
Yeah,
but
that was the original.
It could be like 3 or 4 inches.
Yeah, and then slot
it
in.
Slot it. Because then the LV4 pumps are actually going to be bigger.
You can just fly that if you want.
Yeah,
you
will.
The LV4 pumps are going to be bigger, right?
No, the internals are actually all the same. You just need different motors. I think you may have missed that. There is some magic to these pumps in that these designs actually work really well for the 4K. Not 100% sure on the 6, but when we did calculation for the 4 kilonewton, this was basically the same diameter for the chamber and the impeller.
And the same amount.
You just need different motors.
What about flow rates? Like, what are the...
Likewise.
Like, 1.5 kilograms versus 1 kilogram for the lux, the distance from where we're around there?
Yeah, so what's driving the geometry of the pump design is the inlet pressure. So this was designed for 45 PSI. If the tank feed pressure changes, that's what's going to make you have to redesign the geometry of the pump itself. If you're coming in at 45 psi, that this physical part right here does not have to change. You just need to
change the speed.
A different motor, higher power at a lower RPM. We have a spreadsheet that does it for you. You just change the inputs. Your RPM will go down. Your flow rate will go up. And your power will go up, I think. That's the relationship.
You said you need a different motor. But if those are 5 kilowatt motors right now.
Yeah,
it's
short, sure.
Though. That's what you need. You need more torque than that motor can provide.
Oh, that's true.
You're hitting the fluid harder, but not spinning as fast. So you're trading RPM for torque. That motor is not enough to put it in torque, which is why it spins so fast. You need in our case, if you want to talk RC stuff, you need a lower KV motor, which would spin slower and have more torque. So it'll be a little bit fatter because the windings have more torque lever arm.
Okay.
It's weird.
We got a made up metric.
It's not kilovolts.
Okay.
I promise.
Okay. How many?
It is the amount of RPM that a motor will spin given a voltage applied.
Okay.
That's what it is. And it took me a while to get joules out of that because that's all I want. I just wanted joules out of that motor. you only get KV stuff in the RC game.
Yeah.
So
just they're dumb.
It's what they do. Sensors.
Yep.
Basically, we need someone to do some stuff. But do you want to talk about the test stand integration stuff?
Yeah, so that's another big thing with the feature of this project is if and how it's going to integrate into the test stand. And depending on how capstones are spaced out over the next few years, it might be worth considering making integration into the test stand a priority for the electric feed system. So you're not designing two completely different measurement systems because the test stand is taking all the measurements you need.
Right.
System.
Okay. You kind of doubled it, those pressure transducers and venturis, because in theory they should be for the same system.
Yeah.
If we're developing that the same.
Yeah, because we're designing this to try to achieve the flow rates and the outlet pressures that you guys want as your inlet pressure. So I think moving forward, if it all depends on the next pool of students and what projects get picked up, but I think that might be a good way to go. So
like have the test stand going and then integrate.
So yeah, if we go back to where you're going, pick a heatsink engine, fire it over and over and over again, make sure it works. Then once you have all the equipment that you use to measure everything, plug the EFS in and then start testing it and using those instrumentation to just run that as well. That way you don't have to rebuy pressure transducers and voltmeters because you already have them on the test stand. Then once you have the test stand working, you integrate the EFS in and start measuring that. That way you don't have to buy everything.
And then you're dialing in the EFS directly into the engine system. And once that's confirmed to check all the boxes that we need, then it'll be that much closer to a full test of everything. An effective LV4 test of all the systems,
pretty much. Dial gauge is free to crowd, in case you're curious. They don't work. Thank you, guys.
That's about it.
Any further questions?
Yes. We'll open up your GitHub account on the screen. Right there. Oh, there you go. Okay, can you make that big? Do that control plus a couple times.
Oh.
There you go.
Okay.
All right, so the 2.2 kilonewton design, open that up. Okay, and your CAD is in the CAD folder?
I would assume so.
Yes.
And if you go into the locked pump? Great. Okay, there it is. Good job. And that was pushed 3 days ago, so it might actually be up today. Good job.
Actually, there's one more update to
make. All right, go back. You're not done. We're gonna show us where stuff is.
Okay.
So there's the IPA pump. There's go back. There was a weird part that was just sitting there for the impeller concept back pressure part.
Oh yeah, sorry. That's
cool. Yeah. That's the thing you were talking about.
That's the vanes on the back to siphon
that
awesome pressure.
Design isn't, I think it is to the cryo size, but that wasn't, I didn't want it to get confused for the next people to think, oh, this actually goes in this assembly.
Yep.
It's just, this is where we're moving forward with that.
If you don't mind, oh no, that's fine. That's totally fine. Okay, keep going. Go back. Actually did 2.2 kilometer design.
Oh, stay in 2.2.
Yeah. And then go to analysis. And those are the things that I looked at before. Those are the design calculation procedure and the XLS, shaft key calculations, impeller deflection. There's a bunch of stuff in there that's all great. You've got X underscore T, I forgot what that is. That's a 3D model.
Yeah, that's a parabolic.
Parasolid.
I was like, it's one of those words.
Okay. That's fine, I guess.
Yeah, that actually
used for the CFD.
Yeah, that was used for CFD.
Oh, so maybe that should go in the CFD folder.
Yeah, I'm looking at it now. This is actually a simulation file. These are just in the wrong folder. Those go.
Those, okay, so click on CFD.
Those are all,
yeah, those are supposed to be in here. These are actually just results, I think. And those are the actual simulation files.
So can you click on one of the PNG files? Just take a quick look at it. Cool. Okay, good. Thanks. Go back. That's beautiful.
So if you want to throw in your 444 CFD paper stuff into that also?
Yeah, that would be very,
cryothermal
very practical.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because
that explains what that results actually mean.
Yes, please.
And that there are shortcomings to it.
And he already wrote the paper.
And I already wrote the paper. So I thought that it was in that folder and I didn't realize it wasn't.
That's great. Okay.
Yeah.
And then this is the cryothermal testing. This is what you guys are talking about.
This is
only
the thermal tolerancing for all the contractors. So
great. Well, some of
these are just frosty pictures.
Well, maybe I add the word tolerancing or dimensions to this.
That's what they were. So these are the files. This is all the what we deemed. So these A, B, and C, each one of the parts. Every one of those letters is the critical tolerance that we wanted to find out how much contraction we got.
Mm-hmm.
So we did warm measurements, froze it, brought it back out, re-measured at those spots. So yeah, that could probably get better for these.
Yep, that'd be nice. Because remember, someone's got to come and understand what this thermal testing doesn't make sense, but thermal dimensional or tolerancing testing would make more sense. All right, go back to the analysis.
Readme that explains that.
Yeah, readme files would in each folder.
Okay. Readme files. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're super easy to know.
Can someone write this down so that we don't forget? Thank you.
We could just replay the video.
You could, actually. Okay.
Just replay the video. Steve's got it live.
Well, I think it's better if you take notes.
Yes.
All right. So go back up.
2.2?
Yep. Power systems. Okay,
oh, that's just
block diagrams. That's fine. Okay. Go down. EFS iteration 2 archives.
Yeah, I didn't know if you wanted this or not. It's everything. It's everything. It's kind of, it might be overwhelming to someone.
It's just archives.
It's just everything that we've done that we, in our Google Drive, we tucked away. We're like, we're not going to look at this anymore.
Fine. That's good.
Yeah.
Archives.
The number of times we've done when an archive found something useful is too high.
Okay.
And then if you go down to the Capstone coursework, is that just the stuff you guys did?
That's, yeah.
Yes.
So each class is broken down, like 91. That was fall term, reports, slides. If you wanted to, you could technically go through our entire year and see how the pump developed through slides and reports.
Yeah,
you
that's
see
cool.
Everything that we learned, everything that went through it all, and then these are all the
so
meetings from everything.
Go to the top level for a minute. If you go down, keep going down a little bit more. This is the readme file, right?
Yeah.
And oh, that's nice that you put that picture in there. That's great.
Yes,
you can also make that picture smaller, by the way.
I figured you could.
It's fine. One of the things I'd like you to do is put a series of links in here.
In the readme.
In the
yep.
readme file.
Links
in
the readme.
It's not hard. And what I'd like you to do is to link to the most important things. And the most important things are the proposal, the requirements, the proposal, final report, all that kind of stuff. So I'm sure there's one document or two documents from each of the 490X classes
mm-hmm.
that you should link to from this top page. And basically, I would love to see a discussion of, hey, new EFS Capstone, here's how you should, these are the files you should read.
Okay.
Here's the intro, here's where the design documents are, et cetera.
That's pretty much where the rest of this last week on campus is going to be, is
yep.
organizing this, uploading drawings, making up the drawings,
yep.
and then uploading everything and then just basically organizing it that way. By the time this week is over, you guys will have
I'm really
exactly
happy with
you
that that's what this last week is for.
That's all this last week is for, just all
so
that documentation
go back up.
Stuff.
And don't forget about the adding the README files to the different folders. Like, what are these things and what happens? Even one sentence is better than nothing. Media?
Fancy pictures.
Just pictures?
Pictures,
okay, that's
videos
fine.
Maybe.
All right, that's fine. And
testing procedures.
Research?
Testing procedures is real thing.
Oh, so this is all the stuff that basically we got either through outsourcing or our own research to basically have all the documentation for the stuff we use. So. Liquid oxygen information, pump design stuff, NASA documents stuff we used, anything that sort of had a small hand in us designing things is in here.
Awesome.
So okay. If anybody wanted to retrace our entire steps, you have all the research and all the citations that are in our reports, anything that would be linked in there.
Okay.
All of that stuff would be in there.
And then EFS iteration 2, that's the archive, sorry.
That's the
archive. Never mind. Testing procedures is your procedures for actually running.
So there isn't one built for that yet. I'm going to do that this week.
Okay.
So there will be one for the crowd one and there won't be one for the IPU because that doesn't work. So, but there will be a procedure for doing a full set test.
Okay.
On if you wanted to do it.
Can you also include any suggestions for this is what we think should be done? Like better instrumentation.
Oh, yeah, no.
Yes.
Everything will be knowing everything we know now. That's how this procedure will go.
Yeah.
So,
awesome.
Insulation, timing, the plug at the end, shutting it off, all of that. It will be this is how you should do it.
Yeah.
That's based on what we learned from the first time.
Probably wouldn't recommend doing it exactly how we did it.
No.
Yeah. You know, the day before our reports were due.
Well, there's your final onboarding report and the README, and then finally, the UTP and purchasing. The one thing I have not yet seen is a bill of materials.
That's going to go in the purchasing folder.
Oh, yeah, that'll probably be good.
We have...
you go into the drive.
Yeah.
It is in here. Oh, no, actually, Tim has that tucked away in the OSG folder.
I believe that might have been the spreadsheet, but it's really unorganized. It's organized from Tim's perspective for each order we put in.
Yes.
Across a bunch of different sheets.
Yes.
I'm going to consolidate that into one table. It's just, here's everything we bought. So
that would be great.
People don't have to click through.
Yeah, the way Tim set it up when we were doing purchase, it's like four different sheets, and we entered in one. It was a lot. That was him communicating with Wise Logo, Helen, and
yes.
Joanna.
It might make sense because we are trying to have some continuing knowledge of how to work with the school moving forward every year, to at least have that available as well. But
yeah, that's
in the archive.
That's the one that's in there right there.
Okay.
That is our actual purchase requests
that
Tim put through.
For at least
that'll stay in
there.
Saying this is the UTP requests that were done, because that's useful going forward for people who get more UTP grants to be able to have some that history of how it's done before. Knowing how it was done before helped us a lot on this one because we suffered through it the first time.
Awesome. One last thing is your Google Drive. There is some stuff there, as long as it's in the PSAS shared drive, it's okay. But all the technical stuff should really be in this drive, in the Google, in the GitHub.
Okay.
Cool.
I think everything, unless it's completely redundant, that was on our drive is on this is on the GitHub, except for some things that are on personal computers that we're still tracking down.
Yeah.
So like the CAM files.
Yes.
And there's documentation that still needs to be made as well.
Yeah.
But otherwise, everything else that was technical and involved from the drive, Bill has magically put onto this GitHub.
Thank you. I could.
Thanks, guys.
No, good. Oh, wait, one last thing.
Yes.
Sorry. Is this is not everything that you guys have physically, is it?
There is some stuff left in the rocket room, and there's one toolbox left in the shop.
Okay.
And we have a lot of, just loose end parts.
Yes.
So one thing that we've never done that we're doing this year is also a physical handoff. And we don't need to do that today, but sometime in the next week or two, I know that Julio's going to be around, so I won't like jump on you guys and scream at you right now. But one of the things that happened last EFS capstone.
Oh, I found all of their shit.
There was shit everywhere.
I found everything that they had.
It was so terrible.
They had tools. They had so many things that we didn't even know existed just in there.
Right.
But
so,
that was kind of what I was hoping we could talk about at the end of it. Like, for the next few days while I was in the rocket room working with pulling everything apart and actually logging everything that we have left that is tools, that is equipment, that's parts, like all of that I want to log out of the rocket room and have some list that knows this exists and have a home for everything because we do have a lot of stuff and we did get to buy a lot of cool stuff.
Yeah.
That we want to.
Sensors or anything that has instructions? You could keep the instructions.
Everything's in the boxes. All our like the pressures just we bought, the lab jacks, they're all still in their boxes with all their original documentation.
Yeah,
that makes
sense.
There
were times I found the thing and I'm like, I have no idea. There's no instructions on this.
Even ESC-1 is still in its box, fully wrapped up. That's common.
Good job.
So,
all right. Outstanding job. This is great.
Thank you,
Josh.